AM 590, KXSP, Omaha's ESPN Radio. It's time for the Metro's only racing talk show. The Front Stretch, presented by Joe's Karting and Council Bluffs. Now, here's Dan Taylor and Buddy Ray.
Well, good morning, race fans, and welcome to the Front Stretch, presented by Joe's Karting and Council Bluffs, online at joeskarting.com. That is karting with a K. Man alive, do we have a lot to get to today, so we're not going to jerk around with a little bit of jib-jab that you and I usually kind of BS about for a couple of minutes. We're just going to get right into it. Man, we have a guy who, frankly, could have lapped the field three times over at the Silver Dollar Nationals for the USMTS feature on Saturday night. Dylan Smith, driving the number 95, A-Mod, locally here. Dylan, how you doing, man?
Oh, doing pretty good. You know, just trying to stay cool. This week it's been pretty warm out.
Oh, it has been. Don't worry. John Walsh told us during Sling and Dirt earlier this week that it's going to kind of cool down a little bit. We're going to have, I think it's a comfortable 80 degrees. I think that's a good, comfortable temperature.
Oh, absolutely. And that's, we got pretty lucky over the weekend for the Silver Dollar that we got some really good weather then.
Oh, didn't we? No moisture, no whatsoever. There was a little bit of wind. But man alive, it was some beautiful conditions. It was absolutely gorgeous, which was a lot better than the 2013 Silver Dollar Nationals when it was about a buck 10 all 3 days. Oh, it was just baked out there. I felt like a turkey in Thanksgiving.
Absolutely.
Dylan, you think the seasonable temperatures that we had last week for the Silver Dollar Nationals, do you think that played a lot into the high quality of racing that we've seen amongst all classes on all three nights?
Yeah, I think so. Not having the track held a little bit of moisture in certain spots, so it definitely made it pretty racy, kept it from locking down. I think you couldn't ask for a better racetrack for three nights of racing.
So I've seen some USMTS shows in my lifetime, but son, damn, you were fast. I mean, you definitely were the class of the field, and I actually had a lot of people asking me, how was the Silver Dollar Nationals amongst all classes? I'm like, well, Burkhofer's going to run up there. Blomqvist is going to run up there. He won. But hands down, Dylan, it was an honor and a privilege to get you, to be able to watch you run that 95 jet car around that track. What did you have going on in that thing?
We've been trying to hit as many USMTS races as we can. We hit every race in the Central Region this year. We've been kind of struggling with the car, but I've been talking to Johnny Sadoff there at Jet, and he's been helping me out, and then he kind of figured something out a little bit right before the Silver Dollar, and it definitely helped that I've got a lot of laps around that place. So I just must have been going too fast for the tires to stay on the wheel was a problem.
That's kind of one question I was going to get to later, but we might as well talk to it now. I want to know your mindset about when that tire rolled. Are you more upset that you missed out on opportunity to beat a class of those kind of drivers, or more upset that you missed out on $4,000?
The money's always good, but it was definitely I was pretty frustrated afterwards, and it was just, we were right there, we had the car good. I would have liked to been able to run at all the laps just to see if I could have made my tires last, if I could have kept my composure. Could have handled lap traffic, could have held off Terry Phillips and Ronnie Sanders. I would have. There's just a lot of what ifs that are still left out on the table after that race, and I don't like coming back to the shop with having those what ifs. But it was pretty frustrating. But still, we had a great weekend. We got a second on Friday night, and then we were able to get back up to sixth after going to the back. Can't really complain when you're racing against that kind of competition.
Let's talk about your start of the career. You're obviously one of the bigger A-Mod drivers in the area, and also a late model driver here and there. How did you get your start in racing?
My older brother Damien, he used to race back, had to be a rider, race stock car and then race modifies right around 2000, that area. I think he raced for 5-6 years. And just going to the track with him, watching him, just had an itch to do it. And then after I graduated high school, started out with the modifies, and that's really it took me a couple years to get going strong. But then about my third year in the modifies, that's when we started picking up some wins, and definitely been having some real good luck and success.
Speaking of those wins, you've had some pretty prestigious wins in your career. Is there one that kind of sits above the rest that you're more proud of, or you're more excited that you were able to get?
Well, the Super Nationals last year, that's a big accomplishment. It's still, I don't know if it's 100% sunk in with me yet. I'll probably have to get back to Boone this year and then kind of remember how big a deal it is. But back in 2009, I was able to win the State Fair race. The last time they had it at the State Fairgrounds in Lincoln there, and I was third coming to get the white, and I end up passing Jordan Grabowski and Dave Tronick in the last lap to pick up the win. It was right at the checkered. It was a really exciting race. So that one definitely stands out too.
Is there a favorite kind of track condition that you like when you talked about the track condition at the Silver Dollar Nationals that favored you? Is there a track condition that favors you?
Give me a little moisture on the bottom, or give me a little moisture, and I always seem to go. But as long as it's racy, as long as it doesn't get one lane either on the high side or the bottom, that's kind of my favorite kind of track. As long as it's racy, you know, and if it's a little rougher, you can deal with it. As long as you give me some lanes to pass on, and that's all you can ask for.
We got a heads up a couple of weeks ago from somebody we were talking to that you may be a bit of a superstitious driver.
Yeah, I have my quirks, that's for sure.
I heard. Heard you don't like to take $50 bills on Friday night.
No, not any race day. You can't have $50 bills in your wallet on race day, and you can't no chicken. Try not to wear no green.
No green.
Which it's always a struggle with my dad because he's always wearing his Pioneer hat. You know, he's a farmer, so we have to make sure we have a spare hat sitting there at the trailer for him when he shows up. But just the chicken, green, and the $50 bills are the big ones.
Have you ever gone to an extreme to prove your point with your superstitions?
Not overly, I guess. I guess to prove the point, you'd have to go against the superstitions, and I'm not willing to do that, you know. But I'm not a big fan of chicken anyway, so it's not hard for me not to eat chicken on race day. So
anybody you kind of battle with in the pits, I always got kind of a kick out of the stories between the Kaziskis and Dave Chase. He used to toss chicken bones in their seats. He would do some of the meanest things just to get under their skin and do a little gamesmanship. Anything like that?
No one's really done anything like that. You know, I got my crew chief, crew guy Lucas, and he's kind of a scrappy little guy. So I don't know if anybody wants to do that. They might have a run in with it.
We're talking with Dylan Smith, driving the number 95 AMOD. What else are you going to be driving? You talked about you did a couple of laps for the super late models. You're going to continue doing that every once in a while?
Yeah, we're going to try to hit all the SLMR races. Alan, Lori Humphrey have given me the opportunity of driving their car for them. We've got it up here at their shop, and we're using their open trailer and give me the opportunity to race that. So we're definitely trying to hit all the SLMR races, and just to help promote the series and see if we can't make that Orange number 6 look good out there. But I'm still need some more laps in it, but haven't tore too much stuff up yet and getting some consistent top 10 finishes. So it's still a work in progress.
What's the biggest thing so far this year you've had to overcome running with the best of the best?
Well, it's definitely a learning curve, just racing against that caliber of drivers and just knowing how to race with them. It definitely, when you get back to the local stuff, it almost puts it kind of in slow motion a little bit, but you definitely got to think quicker and react quicker. And having the jet mod, we've been, no one else runs a jet mod for USMTS, so we've been kind of having to try to figure things out on our own, and Johnny's helping us a lot, but it's still kind of a work in progress there, but it's definitely a lot of fun. I've seen more new racetracks this year traveling with USMTS than any other year I can remember, so I enjoy that part of it, too.
What are your plans for 2015? I know we're kind of jumping the gun here. You got a lot of racing left in 2014, but are you planning maybe to start transitioning more towards late model, or what are your thoughts for the future?
There's a lot of thoughts. There's always late model, run some more USMTS. It's just, when you do all that traveling and I'm away from home, it's hard to get all the work done when I'm not around. Can't make no money when I'm not working, so... kind of struggle with that part of it, but we're kind of leaving our options open for next year. Like you said, a lot of racing left in 2014, so we got to get through that first. But I'm sure I'll be racing something somewhere for sure.
Well, let's talk about what is left in 2014. What do you got left for some weekly racing and some big specials you got coming up that the fans can come out and watch you?
We have the next couple weeks. I think we'll have just weekly stuff, and then we're going to try to head over to Britt, Iowa for the night of 1,000 stars there. I think that's in 2 weeks. And then we have like a Jets state fair race, state championship race, somewhere at the end of August, and Super Nationals, then Tiny Lund, the Cornhusker Classic at I-80, and probably hit, maybe try to get down to some specials down south of the USMTS also. So it's I try not to look too far ahead because then it just kind of makes your brain hurt a little bit because all the work that's coming up. So just kind of take it week by week.
We're talking with Dylan Smith, driver of the number 95 AMOD, just 26 years old.
Dylan, a lot of fans out at Eagle Raceway want to know, when are you going to be back to tame those high banks at Eagle Raceway?
You know, we're thinking probably in a couple weeks here. Maybe not this Saturday, but next Saturday. We're going to try to get out there. We'll definitely be back before the end of the year. We just been heading to the cool on Saturday nights because just for one fact, you get home a lot earlier. It's only 40 minutes from home, and it tends to be at Eagle that you kind of lose track of time there. There's a lot of fun, a lot of people hanging out, and a lot of adult beverages handed out over there. So you kind of lose track of time at Eagle. So McCool, you're definitely going to get home earlier.
So what you're saying is Eagle's got its own time zone, Eagle time.
Yeah, it's kind of like walking into a casino. You know what I'm saying? I think he does it on purpose. You know.
Dylan, what's the best way for fans to follow you and maybe even pick up a couple of little bit of Dylan Smith Racing merchandise?
Probably the best way right now is Facebook, just Dylan Smith Racing on Facebook. It would be the best way. Kind of in between on our website, but we try to keep the Facebook updated on where we're going to be at and some results on there. So that'd be the best way.
Dylan, it's always been an honor talking to you, man. It was great to meet you down in the pits at the Silver Dollar Nationals. You've got our best luck to making sure and whooping the field next year for 2015.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Yeah, hopefully I can keep all the tires on the car next year.
You'll get it done. You did an interview here. We're good luck.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, man. Have a good one. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Bye.
Always a great interview, Dylan Smith.
He's always been a class act, and we've had him on the show before, but I always love talking to him.
Literally, I heard the crowd cry over the roar of the engines when he rolled that tire.
When you were in the crowd, I was down on the front straightaway with my radar gun.
Did you hear him cry?
I could hear him cry. I could hear the man in the moon crying. I could hear the whole crowd crying. But you know what was really cool is even for a weekly show, when he came back out, they went nuts.
Yeah.
Every time he passed a car, they went nuts.
Absolutely. All right, we got a big show lined up for you. Turn two, Jimmy Small of Iowa Speedway will join us. Turn three, Ty Dillon and Brendan Gaughan of Richard Childress Racing will join us. Turn four, we're going to find something else. But all day long, we have your chances. Well, not all day long. All show long, we have your chances at winning tickets to Iowa Speedway for this weekend for the K&N Series race on Friday and the Nationwide Series race on Saturday. Here's your question number one. Be the first caller to give me this answer, and I will give you a pair of tickets to this weekend. What car number does Brendan Gaughan currently drive in the NASCAR Nationwide Series? What car number does Brendan Gaughan drive in the NASCAR Nationwide Series? Give Craig a call, 402-573-0590. The first person to call in and answer it correctly gets a pair of tickets to both races, Friday night K&N, Saturday night Nationwide. What car number does Brendan Gaughan drive in the Nationwide Series? We'll be back in turn two to talk to Jimmy Small. This is The Front Stretch, presented by Joe's Karting on AM 590, Omaha's ESPN Radio.
The best bike night on the planet continues with the hottest Wednesday nights around at Quaker Steak & Lube. Smoking hot deals like $6.99 Lube Burgers or $3 Busch Lights, $4 aluminum pint bottles. Smoking bands on the Lube stage and smoking giveaways like concert tickets to Firehouse at Ralston Arena or Stir Cove. Bike night at Quaker Steak & Lube, brought to you by Holstein's Harley-Davidson. Each and every Wednesday night, where there's never a cover charge and always a great time. Quaker Steak & Lube, next to the Mid-America Center in Council Bluffs. 40 years and still smoking.
This is Andrew from Kaziski Auto Parts. Kaziski Auto Parts is an insurance quality used parts supplier that can match your foreign or domestic car or truck needs. If you have a damaged or broke down car or truck, we guarantee a clean and quality part in next day fashion. Kaziski Auto Parts, your neighborhood premium recycled parts supplier. Call any Kaziski Auto Parts salesman today by dialing 402-731-4592 or visit us at 5040 I Street in Omaha. Kaziski Auto Parts. Our quality used parts will match your car or truck's needs.
Are you ready for fast-paced, adrenaline-pumping, wheel-to-wheel racing right here in the Metro? Get to Joe's Karting in Council Bluffs and see what it's like to race real go-karts. Joe's Karting knows it's no fun to race go-karts at 10 miles per hour, so they ripped the governors out, and now the only restriction is how good you are at racing. It's full-throttle, white-knuckle racing every day of the week. Head over to joeskarting.com for hours, prices, and specials, or give Buddy a call today and set up your group races at 712-256-5278.
We're working the High Line into Turn 2 on the Front Stretch, presented by Joe's Karting, online at joeskarting.com.
Heading into turn number two here on the front stretch, presented by Kaziski Auto Parts, online at KazuskiAutoParts.com. Talking with president of Jimmy Small, the final race weekend is just around the corner for Iowa Speedway, August 1st and 2nd. That's this coming weekend for the Iridium. I thought I prepped for... That's the Autolite Iridium XP 150 NASCAR Nation K&N Pro Series on Friday and the U.S. Cellular 250 presented by New Holland. NASCAR Nationwide Series on Saturday. It's a night race. Make sure you get your tickets today, iowaspeedway.com or 866-RUSTY-GO. Jimmy, it's great to talk to you again, buddy.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Oh, we've missed you. You haven't been busy or anything, have you?
No, just you know, doing our best to stay busy and just waiting for this weekend to arrive, so...
You guys just completed a dodgeball tournament earlier this week with Brendan Gaughan and Ty Dillon of Richard Childress Racing. I heard a little bit of trash talking. We're going to hear from those guys later in the show, but they were doing a little bit of trash talking on you.
Yeah, they beat me up pretty good. I actually, we were warming up on another trampoline just down the way, and I had to go and try and show off and do a backflip that I'd never done before and tweaked my back on landing. So I lost a little speed off my fastball there for dodgeball, and I didn't show up.
Are you gonna have? Are you gonna have one of those goat carts like Tony Stewart had when he broke his ankle going around Iowa Speedway?
You know, it's too early to tell, but I'm lining options up right now.
You're lining options up.
Are you gonna paint it up with U.S. Cellular and Autolite logos?
Yeah, I mean, we got to have our primary and a backup ride just in case, right?
Absolutely.
He'll be known as Sparky at the racetrack.
That's a really cool competition you guys lined up. Something very that you don't normally get to do. That you brought in a big name like Ty Dillon and Brendan Gaughan to come play dodgeball with people. How did that come about?
Well, we have a good relationship with a go-kart track just around the corner from Sky Zone, and we had seen it. We had driven by it a number of times, and it seemed like a really, you know, cool place to not only have drivers come out and have fun, and that's when we're all in our best moods and best environments, but also to get some fans involved. So we gave opportunity for two fans to come play along with us, and I think we split them up. So one of them won, or only one of them could win. But, you know, Ty's a baseball player growing up, just like his brother Austin. And Brendan was a basketball player in college, too. So both were good athletes growing up and, you know, chose racing over the other and had a lot of fun. I mean, we all had a blast.
You pulled some strings, and you've got a really cool event coming up this Thursday. Talk about your parade of haulers coming up Thursday through Newton.
Yeah, we've done this on the NASCAR side for a number of years at a number of racetracks, and actually the funny story behind this is when the NASCAR Camperwell Truck Series first came here in 2009. To Newton, Iowa and Iowa Speedway, I was actually working on the series side or on the NASCAR side and actually organized the original hauler parade that we're now sort of, dusting off a little bit and reigniting. So kind of funny to be on this side of things now and really excited. We're going to have about 20 haulers drive all the way through Newton and have some other fun things we're doing with the city along with that as well.
That's kind of one of those cool things that you got to go and see once. You know, it's like Yellowstone or the Grand Canyon. I mean, it's one of those things that you're only going to get an opportunity to see it once in a great while, and it's going to be something that's going to be really cool to check out at least once in your life.
Yeah, you know, I think some of us a lot of us race fans often wish we can see one hauler at least, you know, on I-80 or on another highway. And it is a treat when we get to see one go by and you're like, holy cow, that one's going to a racetrack. That one's got two race cars in it. But to see 20 or more all lined up and they're prettied up too. We wash them right before they go out, so they're looking real good. And it's a special place, and you're right. They don't line up like that very often, and we're really happy to be bringing that to
the city of Newton.
Well, we're talking to you today to get ready for the Autolite Iridium XP150 NASCAR K&M Pro Series in the U.S. Cellular 250 New Holland NASCAR Nationwide Series race. So last time the Nationwide Series invaded Newton, Iowa and Iowa Speedway, you guys brought an amazing level of entertainment, and I couldn't have been more entertained for a 48-hour window with rock climbing walls, extreme motocross shows, concerts. I'm still going to try to tackle that riding. Is the riding bowl going to be back for me to tackle it on Saturday?
Yeah, Piston will be back.
Great. I look forward
he'll have
to
both of his horns on.
I'll get both of them.
So watch out.
One will be riding a bull, one will be talking bull.
Oh, I didn't know you were going, bud. So what do you guys got lined up for this weekend for fans when they get to Newton? Not just obviously the two races, but a lot of excitement outside of the track too.
Yeah, we've got quite a bit. We haven't made all of our announcements yet, so still, and I know you guys hate to hear this, it's a little early to mention everything, but we've got a number of ideas that we've been working on all the way dating back to January and February of this year, and some of those ideas we couldn't pull off in time for May, and so we said, all right, let's hold off on a couple of these, tweak them a little bit more, improve them slightly, and that way we're fully ready for an August release. So other than telling you Piston will be back and we'll be, you know, revamping the Turn 4 bar area with more games, we actually had West End Salvage, which is a reality show based in Des Moines on HGTV. They actually went to a junkyard, found old car parts, and created new tailgate games for us. So we'll have all of those featured, among many other things as well. And, you know, we'll make announcements in the next few days regarding all of that. But really exciting. I think what everyone saw in May and then saw last weekend or 2 weeks ago here in July will be very familiar with what they see again, but will be, I think, pleasantly surprised with some of the other things we'll be announcing in the next few days.
Jimmy, when a lot of people come out to Newton there at Iowa Speedway and they're watching a really good Indy race or a Nationwide Series race or a K&N Series race during the day, Iowa Speedway is one of the most inviting, warm, friendly places that you could ever go watch a race. But how electric and how much more exciting is it to sit in the stands and watch this under the lights?
You know, racing under the lights is, it's hard to describe, you know, where it's such a unique facility, and it's such a, what do you want to say, an intimate environment to watch a race or watch any sporting event for that matter, and to watch it with everyone sort of just sitting right over there just on top of the start-finish line, and to have the lights set up the way they are, and to have Victory Lane just beyond the start-finish line, and for everyone to be able to see Victory Lane and to see pre-race and see driver introductions, and you know, that combined with the fireworks show and all the other pageantry that we have involved, it's really special. And I tell you what, I've gotten goosebumps the last two weekends, and you know, having worked in the sports last 6 years, you know, there are certain pieces of the event that still give it to you, and we're looking to you know, have as many of those as possible to create additional moments, and I think we're spot on with where we're at right now.
I think intimate's probably got to be the best word you could use to describe Iowa Speedway. You hit it right on the head there. Sitting in any seat. When I was there a couple of weeks ago for the IndyCar Series race, I kind of hopped around the racetrack, and you say it trying to sell tickets, but it's God honest, you can't say it right enough that there isn't a seat that has a good view in that track, that doesn't have a good view in that track, that you don't right. feel like you're just peering right over the action, that you could reach out and slap, you know, Ryan Hunter Ray a high five, or Ty Dillon, or you know, one of these guys. I mean, it's a tremendous track. I love going there.
Yeah, we're very fortunate to have a facility like this in either sport, you know, NASCAR or IndyCar, and for NASCAR to come in and purchase and now operate in Iowa Speedway. We're all very thankful as a staff, and I think the fans are really starting to understand where we're headed with this, and gosh, is it fun to interact with everyone and you know get the feedback that we're looking for to make this experience, you know, the best any race fan, any sports fan has seen anywhere.
One last question for you. I know we may be, you know, getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, but your first season as president of Iowa Speedway is about to come to an end. Talk about your rookie season. How would you grade your first experience in our Midwest?
Oh, man, I haven't gotten that question asked yet. That's you're putting me on a tough spot here. I'm used to getting A's in school, right? So, but I'll be honest, I'm pretty hard on myself, and we're really focused on long-term growth here. So, I think I'm going to give myself a B+ here.
I think that's
happy with the way the season's gone. I think the biggest struggle or the biggest challenge for us has just been timing. Like I said, there are a couple of things or a few things we wanted to pull off in May, and we just didn't have time to get it all together. And, we're only going to present things, initiatives, events in front of our fans if we feel, 100% supportive of them, if we feel like we've put everything we possibly could into them. So timing has been the biggest challenge. And then, getting my feet wet a little bit too. And we've got a couple other staff members that are really doing a good job, but we're learning more and more about this market. We're getting to meet more and more of our fans every day and listen to their feedback and tweak our product. And, I can't wait to get back into 2015. I can't believe I'm saying that because I can't believe that we're already ending our 2014 season. But really, really excited about what we've accomplished this year and even more excited about what we now have the time to accomplish in 2015.
Jimmy, we greatly appreciate your time, as always. Look forward to this coming weekend, August 1st and 2nd, the NASCAR K&N Series and the Nationwide Series Invade Iowa Speedway. IowaSpeedway.com, 866-RUSTY-GO for tickets and information. Have a great weekend, man, and we love talking to you, as always.
Thanks so much. See you guys soon.
Have a good one. I think he was being a little modest on that B+.
You think?
I think we got to experience the track before NASCAR took over, and there's a level of expectation when NASCAR takes over a track. I think they exceeded it and they beat it. And I couldn't be more thrilled. I said when they took over, my biggest worry was that it was going to turn into a little Kansas Speedway. And that's not a bash on Kansas. Kansas is a big facility. They're a big time track. I loved the fact that Iowa Speedway was like walking into a dirt track, and I think they've done a great job of bringing in extra things for you to do so you don't just show up 20 minutes before the green flag, walk in, grab a six-pack of beer, sit down and watch a race.
I was going to tell Jimmy I was going to give him an A+ if you can get on Piston, because that is the only attraction I've ever seen you run from. Is the mechanical bull. You get Dan Taylor on Piston, I'll give you an A+.
All right, before we wrap up this turn and head over and talk with Ty Dillon and Brendan Gaunt, I got a trivia question for you. The first one to call in with the answer to this trivia question is going to win yourself a pair of tickets to this coming weekend's K&N Series race and US Cellular 250 NASCAR Nationwide Series race. Here's the question. What racetrack did Brendan Gaunt get his first win at this year in the NASCAR Nationwide Series? Be the first one to call in, 402-573-0590. 402-573-0590. What was the first track that Brendan Gaunt got his very first win at this year in the NASCAR Nationwide Series? 402-573-0590. Ty Dillon, Brendan Gaunt, just around the corner. We're rolling on. This is the Front Stretch presented by Joe's Karting.
For 50 years, Eagle Raceway has been pushing the limits of dirt track racing. Saturday nights, come see the Midwest's best battle at the fastest third-mile track. Gates open at 5:30 for IMCA Modifieds, Sport Compacts, Hobby Stocks, Sport Mods, and Race Saver Sprint Cars. Eagle kicks their season off on April 19th with the Icebreaker Challenge, featuring the debut of the Race Saver Sprint Cars. Located just 10 minutes east of Lincoln on Highway 34 and online at eagleraceway.com.
Driving home from work, you try to beat your best time. Even though your neighbor started mowing first, you finish first. And when you see the shortest checkout line, you race to it. That's because there's a race fan in all of us. Experience a different kind of race at Iowa Speedway on August 2nd for the U.S. Cellular 250 NASCAR Nationwide Series. Tickets start at $20. Buy your tickets at iowaspeedway.com or call 866-RUSTY-GO.
Are you ready for fast-paced, adrenaline-pumping, wheel-to-wheel racing right here in the Metro? Get to Joe's Karting in Council Bluffs and see what it's like to race real go-karts. Joe's Karting knows it's no fun to race go-karts at 10 miles per hour, so they ripped the governors out, and now the only restriction is how good you are at racing. It's full-throttle, white-knuckle racing every day of the week. Head over to joeskarting.com for hours, prices, and specials, or give Buddy a call today and set up your group races at 712-256-5278.
Time to grab another tear off and make your move. We're headed into turn three on the front stretch, presented by Joe's Karting.
Welcome back to the front stretch, heading into turn number three, presented by Iowa Speedway, online at iowaspeedway.com. Getting you set for the U.S. Cellular 250, presented by New Holland, as NASCAR Nationwide Series is headed to Iowa Speedway. 866-RUSTY-GO for all of your ticket information. And to get you set for that race, we've got Ty Dillon on the phone, driver of the number three truck for Richard Childress Racing. Ty, appreciate you joining me.
Well, thanks for having me on.
You just got done with a little bit of a dodgeball tournament. How'd that turn out? Did you win it for everybody?
Yeah, it was great. We had a lot of fun, and I was able to beam my teammate a couple times, and he was able to get me back to you. But we had a lot of fun, and it was cool to be out here.
I saw one video of you getting him pretty good. Were you worried that maybe he'd break a shin or something? I mean, he is 39.
Yeah, he's still pretty athletic. He surprised you. He still got to this. He jumped over top of one of them I threw at him, so I was pretty impressed.
Wow. All right. We're talking about Brendan Gaughan, driver of the 62 truck, or the 62 car, your teammate in the NASCAR Nationwide Series. Ty, I talked to you a couple of months ago at Iowa Speedway when you were up there for the Get to Know Newton 250. I was really impressed, and I kind of took away kind of a memory I think will stick with me for quite a while. I walked up to you after talking with Brendan Gaughan. You were just kind of standing, holding up some tires, and I asked you to do a liner for my show, and this is the liner you gave me.
I'm Ty Dillon, driver of the number three Bass Pro Shops Westco Yuengling Light Lager Chevrolet in the NASCAR Nationwide Series, and you're listening to The Front Stretch.
And as I walked away, I turned around and said, man, how do you remember all that? And I'll never forget what you said. It was something I believe your grandpa, Richard Childress, said, it pays to remember.
Yeah, it definitely does. It can get you a lot further, and it's a good skill to have sometimes.
I want to drill into that a little bit more because I'm hoping to pick up some tips. We've only got a few sponsors for this show, and sometimes I forget them. Is there tricks that you remember to try to remember, you know, what sponsors are coming on for the full season, which ones are just a half season? I mean, it's got to be tough with the way sponsors circulate nowadays.
It does, but I think it's just familiarity with the sponsorship and knowing what you're talking about. And when you're comfortable talking about something, it just rolls off your tongue and you're able to mention it when you're supposed to. And I think that's a good thing to know, is not only know, you know, what your sponsor is, but know the ins and outs, know their competitors, know what they're doing throughout their company. And I think when you get so familiar with your company that you're working with, the sponsorship, you want to promote them, so it makes it a whole lot easier.
And you do get pretty comfortable with those guys. It's not just, oh, here's somebody on the side of my car. You actually go out and work with these guys and try to find fun, interactive ways to kind of promote them?
Yeah, definitely. We spend a lot of time with our sponsors. I have a lot of great people that we're associated with, and people like the Yuenglings are new to our sport, and we've been able to grow very close with them and knowing their business and the ins and outs. And also with Johnny Morris and his family at Bass Pro Shops, we've known them for so long and know what makes their business run. And also with Westco, we've had a 3-year relationship with them now, and they were on my second ever race that I ever ran in the Nationwide Series. First race was actually South Point Casino with Brennan's paint scheme, and it was a moment I'll never forget, my first Nationwide start, and it's a pretty cool opportunity, but he constantly reminds me of that. So I'm actually sitting here beside him, and it's nice to have a relationship with people and to be able to grow. As I'm growing in my career, I can see how their companies are progressing and hopefully help grow their companies as well.
And talk about growing. You said a couple of weeks ago you kind of feel like you and crew chief Danny Stockman are really kind of starting to jive together. That it's always an interesting dynamic between the driver and the crew chief. It's something that can either make you successful or just completely ruin your season. Is that jiving continuing? You guys really starting to work well together and can start knocking off some wins?
Yeah, we are. You know, we're coming off a lot of momentum from our first top five at Chicago, and our last two runs in a mile and a half have been really good. We kind of had a little bit of a down week in New Hampshire, but our confidence is getting higher, and our momentum is definitely at our back. So we're pushing to get better and better as we go throughout this year, and me and Danny are really starting to figure out what I need in the race car and be able to communicate very well on and off the racetrack.
You're set to make your first Cup Series debut next month at Atlanta. Do you know, is Danny going to be your crew chief for that race?
I'm looking forward to that, and we still haven't really fully worked out the details. I'm not totally sure yet, but I am looking forward to that opportunity. Not really sure on all the details right now.
Are you excited, nervous? Is it just going to be another you know, couple hundred laps in the seat for you to kind of get prepared for when you do make that move to Cup?
Yeah, I'm excited for the experience, and I'm sure I'll be a little nervous on the day. You know, it'll be my first Cup start, so I'm looking forward to it. I'm very excited.
You are, before you guys head to Indy, obviously you guys were, we talked to you earlier in the week, and then you guys went and raced at Indy, so we don't have those results yet, although it'd be kind of nice to be able to look into the future and see what you could do to win that race. You're fourth in the points, 30 points back. There's 15 races left in the season, including obviously Indy, but how are you guys strategizing the rest of your season to be able to pick up them 30 points and put the number three back in championship lane at Homestead?
Just continue to do what we're doing and get top fives and wins, and if we can get wins, the points will come. And we just got to keep knocking off good finishes and let everybody else make mistakes around us, and we'll have an opportunity at the end of the year.
Are you kind of looking at the Cup Series win in your in form of points and hoping maybe they bring that down to Nationwide some of these days?
Keeping the Nationwide Series points unique is good for the series. I think the Sprint Cup Series is doing a great job of mixing it up, and I like what they're doing with the series, but I think keeping a little bit of differences between the series is not a bad thing, and I like the excitement of the Cup Series and the way that it's going to come down at the end of the year, but you know, it's also something different to race for and a different way to learn how to race for a championship and when you're trying to get experience in the Nationwide Series.
Well, we're talking to you today to get everyone ready for the U.S. Cellular 250 presented by New Holland at Iowa Speedway for the NASCAR Nationwide Series. You were there in May, I believe. I'm trying to use my memory. Sixth place finish?
I think we were seventh or eighth. I'm not sure. We didn't really have the run that we wanted. I love Iowa Speedway, and it's been a track that I've always been able to feel like I've ran well there. And, you know, we kind of struggled a little bit through the day, but I think we got a good solid finish out of it. And hopefully when we come back to the U.S. Cellular 250 on August 2nd, we'll really be able to make some noise, and maybe it'll be our first win.
Having Brendan Gaughan as a teammate in that 62 car, is it nice to be able to go over to him, somebody who's kind of a, you know, like we kind of joked about, he's 39, that's kind of getting to be up there in the veteran status when it comes to racing in this series. So is it nice to have him to kind of pool on some information?
Yeah, it really is, and all the experience that he has in all the different series has been very helpful to be able to pull from his knowledge, and he's been a great teammate not only this year but last year and, you know, through the past couple of years of my career. So love having him around. He's a great guy and a good guy to throw dodgeball at.
One last question for you before we let Ty Dillon go, driver of the number three Bass Pro Shops, Richard Childress Racing number three truck. About Iowa Speedway, you know, everybody has kind of their favorite things when they go to tracks. Is there something that you've been able to pick up at Iowa Speedway that is your favorite thing to do there? Is it going into the town of Newton? Is it maybe going over to Grimes and playing dodgeball? What have you found something fun you love to do?
Yeah, I love stopping by the Bass Pro Shops outside Des Moines on the way to the racetrack, and I've been there quite a few times and met a lot of people, done a lot of fan appearances there. They have a cool bowling alley. Actually ate there when we landed last year, and but I really love the area that the racetrack's in, and I usually don't, you know, stray too far out of town because Iowa's one of my favorite places, and it's such a pretty area that I like just hanging out and being at the racetrack, and I like to get in race mode there, and I try not to stray too far no matter where I go.
All right, Ty, I appreciate your time. If you would hand the phone over to Brendan Gaughan, your teammate, and we'll talk a little trash but not too much about you.
All right. Hi, guys.
Hey, Brendan, how you doing, man?
Oh, I'm always well. It's a fun day at Sky Zone. You know, I got to crush my teammate in an unmentionable area one time. So that was
I thought he was talking a little higher than I've normally heard him.
His pitch is up an octave or two. You know, he still hasn't quite recovered yet.
Brendan Gaughan, driver of the number 62 South Point Chevrolet for Richard Childress Racing. Brendan, it's great to have you back on the show. We interviewed you last May when you were at Iowa Speedway, and we had an absolute awesome time sitting in the holler and joking around with you.
No, we appreciate it. You know, Iowa's one, like I was saying, Iowa is really one of our favorite places to come, and I got the Speedway always brings me to cool events. I came to the Iowa Fair last year to do some media for the, you know, the Iowa races, and this year we came to Sky Zone to do some dodgeball, and even had some of the girls from the Speedway go and join us out there, and everybody looked pretty sporty, except, well, you might want to check on Jimmy Small next week just to make sure he's okay.
Was he just a little slow and lanky, not really all that athletic?
No, actually, he
I think he threw a mean curve and got you on one at one point. But he took one to the face pretty good one point, and Jimmy got. Let's just say we need to check on Jimmy Small and make sure that Iowa Speedway is running well this week.
We'll make sure
he's okay. You know, we got to keep the Speedway up and running well, and Jimmy does a great job with it, so we got to keep him healthy.
Absolutely. What was your favorite thing about the Iowa State Fair last year when you were there?
My favorite thing was trying to get in the race car when I got to the next race, because it was quite a food fest. You guys, that is one of the neatest fairs I've ever been to, and it is one of the biggest in Minnesota.
Yeah,
you know, they battle back and forth, but it was really cool. A lot of memories. You know, Tom Thumb Donuts, I was reminded of this morning when I got here, and I think I needed one after the Sky Zone trampoline.
It's always amazing. Every year I go back there for the Iowa State Fair, you always find what new they have found to batter and fry.
Yeah, and don't forget the butter cow.
Oh, and the butter cow, exactly. In May, we talked to you. You were very confident about your car and about your chances of getting the win. I believe you came home in 12th place. So what did you pick up from the May race that you're going to be able to apply and improve on for this weekend's race coming up
We were in top five most of the day, and we had a right front tire go down. And we got lucky that we didn't put it in the fence. We got to pit road, but it you know, just put us behind all day. Mm-hmm. We had to pit under green and had to chase back the track position and got all the way back to 12th. We were coming to RCR, ECR, you know, our motors, our engine shop. We have come with some great stuff lately. Richard put a big emphasis on the Nationwide cars, and if you look at how well the team's been running lately, it definitely shows. Paul Menard won. Ty Dillon got the top five at a mile and a half this week. Brian Scott won the Nationwide Dash for Cash. You know, a lot of good things happening around ECR, RCR. So Iowa should be one of those things where we've run great. We've got some new chassis stuff coming down, so we should be able to come to this track and hopefully be just that a little bit better, because we were a top five car last time we were here. And hopefully our Chevrolet will be just maybe a top one or two.
There you go. And you got your first win at Road America a few weeks ago, and it was a pretty emotional win for you. Talk about the confidence coming off of that win. Can you take that confidence and that success from a road course and apply it to a track like Iowa Speedway?
Absolutely. We've been trying to keep that momentum going. You know, we had a great race in Kentucky in the South Point Chevy. Then we went to Daytona and had just a typical Daytona. But, you know, we've been fast every week, and all the ECR, RCR cars have been fast every week. Ties, you know, is got his first top five of the year, and we were fast in practice every session. One of us, either Cale Conley, Ty, Brian, myself, we were always on top of the board. So we're expecting big things. Going to Indianapolis, of course, this week, which is a huge event for us. Got to qualify for that Dash for Cash, though. So when we come back to Iowa, I got a chance at running here for $100,000.
Oh, that'd be a big payday for you guys for the Nationwide Series, $100,000 payday.
Oh, we look forward to it. Brian Scott won the one this week at Chicago, and Ty and Brian are both eligible this week at Indianapolis. So let's try to get an RCR guy, win another $100,000, and then get me to qualify, and I'll go win it at Iowa. Sound good, Ty?
Iowa Speedway is starting to become notorious for its bumps. Is it hard to handle your car when you're dealing with those bumps? Does it just give an extra layer of difficulty to the race?
No, it's just character. That's everybody has to go through the same bumps. You know, I mean, I love guys that complain about something like that. It's like, well, the guy that won the race drove the same bump you did. So, you know, make your stuff work better, give better feedback, you know, do something different.
Yeah.
And we have, the Speedway is great. It's multiple groove. It runs like a Speedway. You know, it's fast. It puts on a great show for the fans every time. And that's the big deal is making sure it's a good show for the fans, because Iowa has great fans that show up, and we always want to try to do the best for them.
Well, you guys have a night race coming up at 7 o'clock, so we're going to see some sparks fly when you guys hit those bumps. Is it hard to keep? I know you're a very calm, cool guy, but is it hard to keep your temper in check when you've got a good car and someone just flat out takes you out?
I'm calm and cool is my moniker. I'm always that way. and the entire room I'm standing in right now is laughing at me. I don't know why. I don't think that was that funny.
Did you lose your cool during the dodgeball tournament?
I never lose my cool. I'm ice, baby.
I'm tuning. You know what? I'm gonna be there on Saturday for the race. I'm tuning into the 62 radio just to hold you to it.
Ty reminded me that I speak perfect Spanish too. You know, no. At Iowa, it's one of those. It's a fast short track. So you get the beating and banging. You get all that sort of stuff that you get at a traditional short track, but you got a lot more speed. you get a lot more, a little bit of aero involved. So you still have to try to keep your fender straight, but that's what makes Iowa such a fun place. You still got speed. The fans still get to see all that, but you still have the action of the beating and banging, and you do have to keep your cool. You can't let those emotions get out of check till the end of the race. Then you can do whatever you want.
All right, Brendan.
Well, okay. I'll do whatever I want. Ty needs to keep in check because he doesn't need to be like me.
All right, Brendan, we appreciate your time as always. Best of luck this weekend at Iowa Speedway for the U.S. Cellular 250 presented by New Holland. Good luck in victory lane, man. Appreciate your time.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate having us on.
Again, Brendan Gaughan, a driver of the number 62 South Point Chevrolet, and Ty Dillon, driver of the number 3 Bass Pro Shop Chevrolet for Richard Childress Racing. You can get your tickets today for Iowa Speedway online, iowaspeedway.com, or wait till tomorrow morning. Give them a call over the phone, 866-RUSTY-GO, for the NASCAR Nationwide Series U.S. Cellular 250 presented by New Holland and the Autolite Indrum XP150 NASCAR K&N Pro Series. It's the final race weekend at our favorite little track down the road. We hope you go down there and figure out what we've been boasting about for the last couple of years. Turn 3 was presented by Iowa Speedway. We'll be back in turn number 4 to wrap this baby all up. This is the Front Stretch presented by Joe's Karting on AM 590, Omaha's ESPN Radio.
So you raced your car this weekend and it ended up on the wrecker. Alter Metal Recycling in Council Bluffs wants to remind you it's not a total loss. Bring it by their modern scrap metal recycling facility and get top dollar for your car. Alter has a full concrete unloading zone, so you don't have to deal with muddy loading zones, and pays on the spot for your car. Alter Metal Recycling is open 6 days a week, with locations in Omaha, Lincoln, Grand Island, and more. Find your location online at altertrading.com.
This week's Young Gun on the Front Stretch is Dylan Lynn out of Atlantic, Iowa. Dylan first sat down in a kart at the age of 12, racing stock medium karts in Messina, and he now runs Pro Clone 360 and 390 karts. At the age of 15, Dylan stepped away from racing, but after losing his father to colon cancer this past year, he swore he'd race again and dedicate each race and trip to victory lane to his late father. Dylan currently races Little Crawford County Speedway and English Creek Speedway in the number 94 Legend Matrix chassis. Dylan knows without great sponsors like RT Motors, A Moment in Time Photography, Uncle Frank's, Cycle Plus, and Linderman Tractors, he wouldn't be able to race, and he certainly wouldn't be running in memory of his father. You can follow Dylan on his quest by liking his Facebook page at Lynn Racing. That's L-I-N-N Racing. Make sure to keep your eye out for Dylan Lynn in the number 94, racing in memory of his dad. He's this week's Young Gun on the Front Stretch.
We have all been there before. Broken car part in your hand and some snot-nosed punk behind the counter has no idea what he is talking about, but he guarantees that this part will fix your car. You pay an arm and a leg for the replacement, get it home, and sure enough, it doesn't fit your car. Now, learn from your mistake and give an experienced salesperson at Kosciuszko Auto Parts a call today at 402-731-4592. Kosciuszko Auto Parts will get you back on the road with your arms and legs still attached.
Are you ready for fast-paced, adrenaline-pumping, wheel-to-wheel racing right here in the Metro? Get to Joe's Karting in Council Bluffs and see what it's like to race real go-karts. Joe's Karting knows it's no fun to race go-karts at 10 miles per hour, so they ripped the governors out, and now the only restriction is how good you are at racing. It's full-throttle, white-knuckle racing every day of the week. Head over to joeskarting.com for hours, prices, and specials, or give Buddy a call today and set up your group races at 712-256-5278.
Get ready for the victory lap as we make our way into turn 4 on the front stretch. Presented by Joe's Karting. Online at joeskarting.com.
Heading into turn number 4 here on the front stretch, and holy cow.
What a show.
I'm not kidding. I was just thinking about it during the break. This has got to be one of our top 10 shows. I mean, to have Dylan Smith, an A-Mod driver, a national champion, a caliber of him, to have Jimmy Small, a nice guy, well-spoken guy, to have Ty Dillon, who's going to be the future of this sport, to have Brendan Gaughan, who is... You have to meet Brendan Gaughan.
You have me as a co-host.
You two... Well, that's... I was talking positives. You and Brendan Gaughan would just talk for hours, which you talk for hours on your own as it is. He would add a little entertainment to it. He's such a nice guy. So fun. I was actually kind of heartbroken when you weren't able to make it the other day, because I was like, God, I was really wishing Buddy could be there, because that'd have been a 30-minute interview if you'd have been there, because you and him would have just gone on and on and on. All right, if you missed any part of the show, head over to the YouTube channel, and I'll get you the last question, 402-573-0590. This is, if you listen to the interview with Brendan Gaughan and Ty Dillon, you heard this answer, so I hope you were paying attention. Who was the primary sponsor for Ty Dillon on his first NASCAR Nationwide Series start? If you were listening to the interview just last turn with Ty and Brendan, you heard it. Who was the primary sponsor for Ty Dillon in his first NASCAR Nationwide Series start?
Can I give a hint?
402-573-0590. Don't give a hint. They should have listened last turn. It was easy to pick it up because we all I laughed about it. It was pretty funny. 402-573-0590. The first person to tell Craig who the answer or what the answer is to the first primary sponsor for Ty Dillon during his first NASCAR Nationwide Series start gets a pair of tickets, gets the final pair of tickets to this weekend's race at Iowa Speedway, NASCAR K&N Series, and the NASCAR Nationwide Series this Friday and Saturday. John Walsh is still in the studio with us, guest starring with us a little bit today. We appreciate you joining us, John.
Well, thank you. This has been very interesting. I've loved every second of it.
We tried to get to it last show when we were live after the Silver Dollar Nationals, but we had more important dirt news to talk about. We were trying to get to it today, but we've only got about 4 minutes left in the show, so we're going to try to get to it as much as possible. This RTA, this is the biggest story in NASCAR, and by the way, thank God it's the biggest story, and we can quit talking about Morgan Shepherd and should the top third or the lower 30 through 43 be kicked off the track, and should there be these... Just let the guys race. It was a once-in-a-lifetime incident that'll probably never happen again, or if it does, it's going to be a decade from now. Let's just talk about other things. So the RTA. We've all got thoughts on this RTA, but let me just, in case you haven't been listening and paying attention, here's what it is. It's the group of the nine biggest team owners in the Cup Series have come together with the intention that if they go to a hotel chain, they go up to Hilton, and they say, we're going to be racing at 38 traveling weekends, and we're the nine biggest teams, and we've got the nine... We have the most employees of any teams. Give us a break on our hotel rooms. Now, you and I have been trying to figure out what it costs to run a race team each weekend for the NASCAR Cup Series. I finally have a rough estimate.
Oh, boy.
Between $1 million and $1.5 million for every car every weekend. $1 million to $1.5 million. Now, let me just break this down. That goes for the chassis, the setups, the tires, the fuel, the shocks, all the parts on the car. That
payroll.
Goes for the near 40 guys that fly in on Wednesday to the racetracks that do the Wednesday through Saturday, get ready for the race, and then they fly out, and then a new crew flies in on Sunday. So there's four flights you've got to book per team. You've got hotel rooms. You've got catering. You've got daily allowance for the teams to spend. You've got salaries. Now, if I as an entity was able to come together with the eight other biggest race teams and say, Hilton, can you give me $50 off on my hotel room? Imagine over a 38 traveling weekends, how much money that would save these teams.
A ton.
That is the stated goal for the RTA, is to try to save as much money as possible. The biggest fear is that they're going to turn to NASCAR during one of these rule changes or one of these rulings and say, we don't like that idea, and we're not going to come to the track until you change it back.
When the RTA first came out, and I was reading the teams talking about it, they were talking about it as more of a collaboration between the teams on sharing info and setups and stuff like this. You know, when it first came out, so I was like, well, what's the difference between having a formal RTA and... You know, Childress just calling up Hendricks, hey, on that 24 car, what do you set the right rear stagger to? I mean,
but let's
do
be
that
frank,
now on the dirt
not,
level.
They're not doing that. I mean,
I'm saying that's what I seen when it first came out on J-Ski.
All that they're trying to do right now is just try to find ways to save money on hotel rooms, on catering, on flights.
When I'm spending $1 million a weekend, I'm going to be doing the same thing.
Oh,
how can
God.
I save money? I'm going to be calling
imagine?
John Walsh. Hey, if I give you $1 million, can you let it not rain so I can race this weekend?
So the RTA has the potential of being very scary for NASCAR.
Yeah, I mean, it really does. And it sounds like they're still in the process of sort of feeling each other out. As I mentioned today, Brian France, yes. He went on, he had a little press conference and was talking about this today, apparently. I read an article about that, and he was saying that they were disappointed when this came through. They're willing to work with him. Both sides are saying the right things. But he also states, you know, we just don't know their agenda right now, and until now they've lawyered up, and the communication process is going to go through a lawyer, which is not a good thing. I don't think that's that could cause all sorts of things. It really does put up walls, and they're almost setting themselves up or thinking that there's going to be some huge legalities that are coming up here, that the trust isn't quite there yet. And maybe that just comes from not knowing exactly what's going to be taking place. But I don't know why any team wouldn't be wanting to save money on this. Now, when you were talking about this $1 million, was that for, as I understand it, 10 years ago, a typical budget was like 10 to 15 million, right, for a season. It's gone up to like 20 to 30 million. Is that what you're
talking about? Yeah, that's basically. I mean, for the higher teams, for like Hendrick, you're looking at more like 30 to 40 million a season. Yeah.
Right. So,
and that's per car.
Yeah.
That's no wonder there's four team race teams and they want to have five and six teams.
Yeah. It's staggering.
They're able to save a little bit of money by pooling their resources as one team, but man alive, $1.5 million for a race weekend.
You know, NASCAR has always, they've run the show themselves for so long, and I think there could be that underlying fear that there's some organization going on here. What is the purpose of this? They're not quite sure, and it's the top teams. That's the other thing too. There could be some leverage there of the decision making down the road, because without those teams, and I didn't want to think that this is on the back of their minds, but you can see boycotts and all sorts of things that could transpire if there is a power struggle as to how they want to NASCAR to run in the future, you know. So I don't know. I think they're probably just going to have to feel each other out and see if they're both sides are operating on good faith or not.
Only time will tell. And unfortunately, we are out of time today. We appreciate you joining us on the Front Stretch. John, appreciate you joining us. Catch John Walsh on Channel 3, The Weatherman. Great guy. Great into getting back into the dirt series and the dirt world and the NASCAR world. John,
love it.
Appreciate you joining us. Can't wait to have you back on the show. We appreciate all of you joining us, and we hope you won yourself a pair of tickets to Iowa Speedway this coming weekend. iowaspeedway.com, 866-RUSTY-GO. All tickets and information on iowaspeedway.com. Quaker Steak and Lube, the official watering hole of the Front Stretch in Council Bluffs. All the NASCAR action for the Indian for the Brickyard 400 on the big screens at Quaker Steak and Lube today. Good day, folks. Thanks for joining us.
The best bike night on the planet continues with the hottest Wednesday nights around at Quaker Steak and Lube. Smoking hot deals like $6.99 Lube Burners or $3 Busch Lights, $4 aluminum pint bottles, smoking bands on the Lube stage, and smoking giveaways like concert tickets to Firehouse at Ralston Arena or Stir Cove. Bike Night at Quaker Steak and Lube, brought to you by Holstein's Harley-Davidson, each and every Wednesday night where there's never a cover charge and always a great time. Quaker Steak and Lube, next to the Mid-America Center in Council Bluffs. 40 years and still smoking.
Driving home from work, you try to beat your best time. Even though your neighbor started mowing first, you finish first. And when you see the shortest checkout line, you race to it. That's because there's a race fan in all of us. Experience a different kind of race at Iowa Speedway on August 2nd for the U.S. Cellular 250 NASCAR Nationwide Series. Tickets start at $20. Buy your tickets at iowaspeedway.com or call 866-RUSTY-GO.
For 50 years, Eagle Raceway has been pushing the limits of dirt track racing. Saturday nights, come see the Midwest's best battle at the fastest third-mile track. Gates open at 5:30 for IMCA Modifieds, Sport Compacts, Hobby Stocks, Sport Mods, and Race Saver Sprint Cars. Eagle kicks their season off on April 19th with the Icebreaker Challenge, featuring the debut of the Race Saver Sprint Cars. Located just 10 minutes east of Lincoln on Highway 34 and online at eagleraceway.com.
Are you ready for fast-paced, adrenaline-pumping, wheel-to-wheel racing right here in the Metro? Get to Joe's Karting in Council Bluffs and see what it's like to race real go-karts. Joe's Karting knows it's no fun to race go-karts at 10 miles per hour, so they ripped the governors out, and now the only restriction is how good you are at racing. It's full-throttle, white-knuckle racing every day of the week. Head over to joeskarting.com for hours, prices, and specials, or give Buddy a call today and set up your group races at 712-256-5278.